Great, you can be seated. I'm going to jump into the Word. I'm going to tee this up today and see how far we can get, and then I'll finish it on as I'm with you over these next few months. But I want to stay on this theme today. One people, one purpose, and one passion. Will you say that with me? One people, one passion, and one purpose. Jesus prayed that they may be one, just as they are one. Can you turn to Genesis? We're going to kick off right from the beginning. Genesis chapter 1, and I'm going to paint some kind of a picture today, and then we'll just see what God does. Amen? Really excited, by the way, to be with you all. Church Family Matters meeting tomorrow night. Got some exciting news. There's lots of stuff happening, and we can unpack that tomorrow night. Genesis chapter 1, the book of beginnings, Genesis chapter 1, verse 28. And Jesus says, he said, God blessed them, and he said to them, be fruitful and increase in number and fill the earth and subdue it. I want you to rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and over every living creature that moves along the ground. This is the great Genesis mandate to rule and subdue and have dominion and to fill the earth. Everyone say, fill the earth. God's purpose is simply this, to fill the world with the people that look just like him. As surely as I live, it says in Numbers, all the earth will be filled with my glory as the waters cover the sea. The glory of God is the nature of God. It's not just a mystic cloud. It's not an event that happens. His glory is his very nature. And his nature is being displayed through the world. Do you remember Moses prayed, Lord said to God, show me your glory, God. And God says, no one has seen my glory and lived, but I will hide you in the cleft of the rock. And when I pass by, you will see my glory. And what he saw was his nature. He saw his kindness. He saw his goodness. He saw his slowness to anger. God's glory is what he's like. So when the earth gets filled with his glory, it gets filled with people that represent what he is like. Amen? That's God's purpose, to fill the earth. Now watch this in chapter 2, verse 7, and it says, the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground, and he breathed, everyone say breathed, into his nostrils the breath of life. Everyone say life. I just want to set this up properly today. That's why I'm going to take just a few moments on this. But God took man that he created and he kissed him on the lips. It was the beginning of a love affair. And that word, breath, in the Hebrew, literally means to desire. God was saying, Adam, creation, man, I desire you. It means to have pleasure in, to love, to cling to delight in. It was the beginning of God kissing him on the lips, breathing into his nostrils the breath of life. And the word life there means this. It means to enjoy, to prosper, to be well, to be refreshed, to quicken. And I love this word. I promise you it's there in the Hebrew, is the word to chill. When God took his man, he says, I love you. He breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And I want you to be well. I want you to prosper. And I want you to chill. I want you to learn to enjoy me. Amen? Yeah. All right, let's keep going. So, if you can turn to Genesis chapter 11. Genesis chapter 11. Remember, God's purpose was to fill the earth. Everyone say, fill the earth. God's purpose has always been to fill the earth. And something happens. There's a little hiccup that happens in Genesis chapter 11. And it says this, now the whole world had one language and a common speech. And as men moved eastward, they found a plain in Shinar and settled there. Everyone say, settled there. Remember, they were told to keep going. Fill the earth, rule it, subdue it, over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and over every living thing. And they said to one another, come, let us make bricks and bake them thoroughly. And they used bricks instead of stone. Side note, remember what God is building is not made of bricks, because bricks are made of mixture, but what God is building is something made of stone, and they are living stones. Let's keep going. And they used bricks instead of stones and tar for mortar. Then they said to themselves, come, let us build for ourselves a city that's towers, reaches to the heavens, so that we may make a name for ourselves and not be scattered over the face of the whole earth. Come, they said, let us build something for ourselves. You know, it's really important that as one people, that we are building something together, not for ourselves, not by ourselves, not for our glory, but by him, for his glory. And if we don't do that, watch what happens. But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower that men were building. And the Lord said, if, watch this, as one people, everybody say one people. If as one people, we've got 3 points today. Number one is we are one people with one passion and one purpose. That's the theme for this year. And here God says, if as one people speaking the same language that they have begun to do this, then nothing will be impossible for them. If by one people speaking the same language, then nothing will be impossible for them. Have you noticed already this morning that prophetically that there is a theme that God is saying you need to break through a barrier? That there's more. I want you to believe in the impossible. And as one people, it's important, first of all, that we speak the same language, but secondly, that we believe for the impossible. You know, without faith, everyone say faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. And faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not yet seen. You know, until the year 1954, now we know your age. It's great, Anne. Were you born on April the 6th? Well, until April the 6th, 1954, on a chilly day, it was 20 degrees C, in front of about 3,000 people. Until that day, no one in recorded history had ever run a mile in less than 4 minutes. But on that day, there was a man whose name was Roger Bannister. And on that day, with a crowd of 3,000 people, he defied what the medics said could never happen. They said it's impossible for the human body to be able to take that much pressure to run a mile in less than 4 minutes. But as the wind speed dies down, although it was chilly, Roger Bannister, who, by the way, went to Beech and Cliff, who, by the way, grew up in the wonderful city of Bath, on that day, he ran a mile in 59.4 seconds. Sorry. That's pretty fast. In 3 minutes. I always do this when the jet lag kicks in. I'm like, what did I say? He ran a mile in 3 minutes and 59.4 seconds. Isn't that amazing? And the world was stunned. It had never happened before in recorded history. And he held that title for 46 days. And then somebody else did it. And then 16 people did it. And since then, many, many people have beaten the 4 minute mile. What's my point? There are paper ceilings in our thinking that we need to smash through. If by one people speaking the same language, nothing will be impossible for them. Church, nothing is impossible. But we put lids on our own thinking because we're told it can never be. But we could say, God, this is what you've said. This is what you've promised. We're going to push through. We're going to go for it. We're going to break boundaries. Amen? Let's believe, as John just said, for the impossible. Mary, John's wife, for 17 years, not being able to taste anything or smell anything. And then Lily, their daughter, precious daughter, lays hands on them while they're watching TV. And they ask her politely, sweetheart, sit down, thank you. And a few minutes later, she jumps up again and does it again and lays hand on them in Jesus' name that mummy may be able to smell and taste. And the next morning, Mary wakes up and she says, John, I can smell. Who are you making coffee? And she comes downstairs and she can smell and she can taste. Hallelujah! That's the impossible. He's the God of the impossible. And he wants us to break boundaries. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. It pleases God when we push boundaries. All right, number two. Number one, one people. Number two, one purpose. One passion. Everybody say one passion. One passion. Turn to Acts chapter 2, if you will, please. Acts chapter 2. You guys have Bibles? That's the thing with all our technology now and iPhones and iPads. You don't hear the swishing of paper anymore. Actually, you can start in Acts chapter 1. One of my favorite books this is in the Bible because it's a book of action. It's not a book of intentions. It's a book of action. It's a book where we see stuff happen. The church begins. But it starts with Dr. Luke writing to his friend Theophilus. And he says, in my former book, Theophilus, I wrote to you about all that Jesus began to do and teach until he was taken up to heaven. And after giving these instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. And after his sufferings, he showed himself to these men and gave them many convincing proofs that he was alive. And he appeared to them over a period of 40 days, and he spoke to them about the kingdom of God. It's interesting that Acts begins with the kingdom of God and ends with the kingdom of God. And Paul boldly closes Acts by preaching and proclaiming the kingdom of God. And they began to ask Jesus, these disciples here in Acts chapter 1, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel? And he says, no, it's not for you to know the times or the dates that my Father has set by his own authority. But, everybody say but. He says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria until the ends of the earth. It's interesting that they start to ask him questions about eschatology. And he says, I'm not really interested in talking to you right now about eschatology. What I'm interested in talking to you about is the great Holy Spirit that is coming to come upon you, to clothe you with power, to anoint you for a purpose. And that's so that you can be my witnesses. And he tells them to wait in this upper room. He says, I want you to wait here in Jerusalem until the Holy Spirit comes. I often wonder if they hadn't been obedient, what would have happened? Oh, there's no point in waiting. He's gone now anyway. The angel said he'd come back. They stood there and it disappears from their sight. And two angels came and they're looking in the sky and says, don't you know he'll come back in the same way that he's left? And then they thought, what did he tell us to do? He told us to wait in Jerusalem until we receive power from on high. So 120 of them are there in this upper room, and they're waiting on God. They're in one accord. Everybody say one. The Greek tense there is that they came to the same temperature. They came to boiling point together. Have you ever been in a room where in prayer and in the spirit you come to the same temperature all at the same time? You know, it's when we come to the same temperature that we come to that oneness in the spirit that the suddenlies of God happen. And suddenly, Acts chapter 2, the Holy Spirit came, and there was a sound like the blowing of a violent rushing wind, and it came and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. And there seemed to be tongues of fire that came to reach, to rest on each one of them. And they went from this upper room out into the streets, and people from every nation under heaven heard them speaking in their own language. Then some of them mocked. They said they must be drunk. And Peter, the same Peter that denied he ever even knew Jesus, just 50 days before, he stands up and he says, "Men of Jerusalem, listen carefully to me. Let me explain this to you. These men are not drunk. It's only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what Joel was talking about. In the last days, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Both men and women, both young and old, I will pour out my spirit, says the Lord." What happened? They were simply given an instruction by Jesus himself, and they were obedient, and they continued to wait for the promised Holy Spirit. They were waiting together. They were waiting with passion. I want to just say this morning. Is it so important that to be in oneness that we are one in obedience? That if Jesus tells us to do something and we do it, then we can expect the suddenlies of God. God rarely moves immediately, but he always moves suddenly. And when we wait in one accord, just saying, "Jesus, we're going to do what you asked us to do," the suddenlies come. And with something that happens, that's why I believe some meetings are thicker of the suddenly presence of God than others. And I believe it's the one in accord. Why are some meetings a little patchy? We kind of hit it and then not quite. But sometimes it's just the hunger level in the room. Why? Because God responds to faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. But when we come with an expectation, when we come with, "God, are you going to be there today? I'm going to meet with God today." God says, "I'm ready. I'm ready to meet you. I was glad, very glad when they said to me, 'Come, let us go to the house of the Lord.'" Because they're singing and dancing. Church, when we come to a meeting, do we come empty, ready to receive, or do we come full, ready to give? Well, I wasn't asked to speak. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the person next to you coming to encourage them, to give them a word, to give them some money, to give them a scripture, to give them a meal, to give them a smile, to give them a hug, to encourage. Proverbs 11:25 says this, "He who refreshes others will himself be refreshed." You know, if you want to be blessed, be a blessing. He who refreshes others will himself. It's a principle of the Spirit. If you water somebody else, if you give to somebody else, you yourself will be blessed. It always makes me chuckle when I see people who are so blessed, and the reason they're so blessed is because they are such big givers. People say, "Well, look at all the stuff they've got." And I think, have you seen the size of the seed they sow? They're big sowers. "For whatsoever a man sows, that he shall also reap. A generous man will prosper." Same passage, Proverbs 11:20. "And he who refreshes others will himself be refreshed." Passion. My mother, who's going to be here with us in a couple of weeks, in a few weeks. Is it in a couple of weeks? Where am I? What day are we on? Nigel? I know I've shared this before. Said this one time. I said, "Mom, I just so appreciate your passion." And she asked me if I knew what passion really meant. And I could tell by the look in her eye, I obviously didn't. And she said, "Son, passion is the degree of difficulty we are willing to endure in order to reach our God-given goal. The passion of the Christ was all about suffering, but it was for the joy set before him that he endured the cross. And you know that joy is us. It's the church. Passion. Turn to the person next to you and say, passion. One passion. See, if one people have one passion, then it doesn't matter if we see a paper ceiling that looks like it's solid. We can say, it doesn't matter, I'm going to believe God for the impossible. Even if the medics say it's humanly impossible, the minute the barrier is broken, we just create more barriers and more barriers and more barriers. Because we keep extending the sphere of our own faith. Church, we've got to keep moving forward. God blesses obedience. Psalm 133 says, where brothers dwell together in unity, God commands, everyone say commands, a blessing, a blessing. He commands a blessing. He commands a blessing. Isn't that wonderful? Therefore, can I suggest that the opposite is true? Where there's not unity, there's not a blessing. And this year, we're looking at different ways of even meeting with other churches in this city and celebrating together and honoring together. Remember, if you were in culture class, unity is the celebration of diversity. Unity is not uniformity. It's the celebration of diversity. Unity is not just all looking alike. We're all so different. We are fearfully and wonderfully made. You are the best you that you can possibly be. Unity is the celebration of diversity. God commands a blessing where there is unity. Another translation says he commands favor where there's unity. I felt to share this today. I've never ever shared this publicly on recording before. I've shared it with a few individuals here in the church. But I was driving a long way once with my family and from Chicago all the way to Florida, and I had the great job of doing the driving. It's about an 18-hour drive. America, as you know, those who've been to the States, is a big country. The lake in Chicago is the same size as England. That's just the lake. But it's a long way. We're doing a trip this some point this year, and it's about 7,000 miles of driving. It's a long way. But on this particular journey, we were driving straight from Chicago all the way to the coast in Florida. And my family was asleep, and I just began to just talk to the Lord and meditate on scriptures, and that's one of the ways I prepare. I think, and then I look up, and I started to ask the Lord about the whole subject of favor, and I said, Lord, what is favor? Because it seems unfair that you would favor some people and not others. Now, this is something that the Lord said to me, okay? So just don't get up and leave. Just hear me out. Because this is not the Bible. This is just, and if you remember, I made a statement once, you and I are not obligated to believe or receive anything that's not in the Word of God. When people say, I went to heaven and God told me this, that's awesome. We're not here to refute your experience, but we're not obligated to build our life on your experience. Do you hear what I'm saying? We build our life on what the Word of God says, because that's sound, that's solid. We can't just live or build our lives on other people's experiences. Amen? With that being said, this is an experience. I said, Lord, what is favor? And the Lord said to me, son, I love everybody, but I don't like everybody. Wait. He said, the reason you like people is because there's something about them that you like. Correct? And whilst God loves us and we're called to love everybody, that there are certain things that God doesn't like. God doesn't like murder. God doesn't like lying. He doesn't like racism. You follow? Those things God doesn't like. So if we are like that, God doesn't like that about us. But when there's things about us that God likes, the reason he likes them is because that's what he is like. So this whole thing of glory, when we act like he acts, he says, I like that, and I'm going to turn my favor towards that. I'm going to bless that. Now, please just don't go to material things. Please don't just go to health and wealth. Please don't do that. Prosperity is a lot more than that. Favor is a lot more than that. That's an aspect of that, could be. But church, here's what I'm saying is, God is attracted to a people that are like him. He loves everybody, but what he likes about us are things about us that are like him. It's the same with us. Some of you in this room, you love everybody in the room, but there are some people you spend a lot of time with, and the reason you spend time with them is because you like them, and the reason that you like them is because there's something about them that you like. Amen? Favor. I then went on to ask the Lord, I said, Lord, do you like me? And some miraculous things happened with that day. I don't have the time, but to unpack it all and tell the story, but just to jump to the end, I ended up sitting on a beach with about 15,000 people, and I ended up sitting with R.W. Schambach's granddaughter. I don't know if anyone know who that is, but R.W. Schambach has gone on to be with the Lord now. He had a healing ministry, which is just very, very profound, and she was a news anchor in Oklahoma City, and they had kind of walked away from the Lord, and I got to minister to them and stay in contact with them, and we became friends. But at the end, as I got walked off the beach, I was handing back the deck chairs to the attendant, and I said, how many people were on the beach here today? And he said, 10 to 15,000, depending on what time of day. And the Lord said, you couldn't have manufactured that. I turned my favor towards you because I wanted to put you in a place where you could be a blessing. Amen? Favor. Everyone say favor. Everyone say blessing. Where brothers dwell together in unity, God commands a blessing. Unity, blessing. I pray that they may be one as we are one. The theme this year is that we are one people with one passion, and we have one purpose. Philippians chapter 2, that's my last point. I want to talk about one purpose. Everyone say, one purpose. We have one purpose. We started with this, that God's purpose is to fill the earth with a people that look just like him. But we have a job to do. And here in Philippians chapter 2, Paul is writing to the church in Philippi. And Philippians chapter 2, and he says this, verse 1, if you have any encouragement of being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and in purpose. Being one in spirit and in purpose. Everyone say purpose. Third point is that we have one purpose. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not only at your own interests, but also in the interests of others. Your attitude should be the same as that as Jesus Christ. do nothing. Church, to have one purpose, to be in one spirit. Ephesians chapter 4, Paul says that God has given apostles and prophets and pastors and teachers and evangelists what we call today the fivefold ministry to keep the unity of the Spirit. In other words, we already have it. We have to keep the unity of the Spirit. And the way that we keep the unity of the Spirit is being together in the Spirit, which means that we walk in the Spirit. Galatians chapter 5 says, live by the Spirit. Keep in step with the Spirit. Be led by the Spirit. Walk in the Spirit. Stay in the Spirit. Keep the unity of the Spirit. We need to keep being together, celebrating our differences. And here, Paul gives us a sneak little peek into what that looks like. Then make my joy complete, Paul says. Make my joy complete. How? By being like-minded. Being like-minded. In this house, in this church, we have a vision. It's a clear vision. It's a clear mandate from heaven. Be like-minded. Having the same love, being one in spirit and in purpose. And then he breaks it down and he says, but listen, do nothing out of selfish ambition. Do nothing out of selfish ambition, but in humility consider each other. Can I just say, to keep the unity of the Spirit, it's important that we don't compare. It's important that we don't compete. And it's important that we don't complain. It's important that we don't compare. The Bible says, don't compare yourself one to another. Don't do it. Everyone say, don't do it. Don't compare yourself with somebody else. Don't compete. You know, we complete one another. We don't compete with one another. We complete one another. In this city, we complete one another. We don't compete with one another. We are not in competition against other churches in this city. We don't compete, we complete. What? And we don't, if we're competing, what we're up against is the spirit of the age, not other churches. What we're up against is homelessness. What we're up against is broken marriages, addictions. What we're up against is an enemy that's bent on doing three things: stealing, killing, and destroying. That's what we're up against. That's what we're competing. That's the competition. And guess what? We win. We win. I've read the end of the book. I always go straight to the end, see if I want to read it. We win, church. It ends really well for us. And that's why we should have more hope than anyone else. He who has the most hope has the most influence. Amen. All right. So let's not compare. Don't complain. Don't complain. You know, complaining is draining. Oh, don't complain. Just get in the game. Say, what can I do to help? We have enough problems. Do you have a solution? But that we all start playing together. It's like, have you ever been rowing with somebody and they're just completely out of sync, just doing their own thing, and the boat's going this way and that way, and it's just annoying. In the end, it's like, just take your oars and put them in the boat and I'll do it. I know that because we did it last summer with Hannah Stolls. She's a little arm. She couldn't do it. Anyway. If you imagine an orchestra where the musicians are playing beautifully and someone decides they're going to bring out their own music and their own instrument and just start playing. What? That's annoying. It's completely out of sync. But harmony and unity is saying, let's play together. Imagine an army where a soldier just wanted to do it his own way. He could put everybody else in harm's way because he wanted to do it himself. Imagine a house that's built without a permit, without planning permission, without architect's drawings. I just want to build this my own way, but it's not according to the pattern. That's why the Bible says line upon line, precept upon precept. You know, sometimes I think in an age where we've really understanding the grace of God, when somebody starts to lead, it gets marked as controlling. It's not. Sometimes it's just leadership. Be like a children in a house. Dad, you're not telling me what to do. What? Can you see? Church, let's listen to the voice of heaven. Imagine the disciples. Yeah, he said, wait here in Jerusalem. But he told us to go into all the earth. So let's just go. I don't see any Holy Spirit anywhere. We've been waiting here for ages. Just wait. Everyone say, wait. 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 You know, when I read about Rogers Bannister and a bit about his life, one of the things that was interesting to me is he rested for a full 5 days before he ran. He rested for 5 long days because he wanted to make sure he'd waited and rested long enough so that he had maximum amount of energy. You know, on the 6th day, God made man. On the 7th day, he rested, which means when man woke up on his first day, he encountered a God who was in rest. Isaiah 40 says, those that wait on the Lord will renew their strength. Then they will run and not grow weary. Then they will walk and not grow faint. Watch this. Those that wait on the Lord. Sometimes we run before we wait and we wonder why we get weary. There's a principle here of learning just to wait on the Lord. Just to wait. Is Andy here? Those who wait. Everyone say wait. You know, the word wait here means to wait with great expectation. To wait with great anticipation. It's like, have you ever seen a man or a child or somebody throwing a stick for a dog? And you look at that dog, the dog is quivering with expectation and excitement, ready for that stick or that ball or that frisbee to release from its owner's hands so it can run after it. That's the kind of waiting that the Bible is talking about. It's not just sitting, having a cup of tea and waiting. It's waiting in a place of peace, but in absolute expectation for what's about to happen. Those that wait on the Lord will renew their strength. I'm sure as Roger Bannister lay in his bed, he wasn't just thinking, oh, I'm just going to just... No, it was a waiting with an expectation. I'm saving my energy for a moment when that gun goes off, and I'm going to break a world record. I'm going to break a record that I was told could never possibly, human possibly be broken. But he did it because he waited first. We had some African brothers stay in our home in the States one time. Fee and I were Bible students, and they were on the same course as us, and we were in one room, and they were in another, and all through the night, they would just be talking and talking, and I'd have to knock on the door and say, brothers, we're trying to sleep, and they would just be sitting on the Bible, on their beds, reading their Bibles and studying, like 4 a.m. I'm like, man, I don't think I'm even saved. I'm just getting mad with them because they just won't shut up. And then they were fascinated by the American culture, how everything was so fast and everything was so quick, and you drive through bank and you drive through pharmacy and you drive through this and you drive through that, and everything was just so easy. And they could see their just heads were spinning at the speed and the convenience. And one morning I came downstairs. I may have told this story before, and our dryer wasn't working, and I had a linen shirt, and I took the linen shirt, and they were watching me as I was making breakfast, and I thought, this would be cool. So I put the shirt that was still damp into the microwave, and I hit 2. And the shirt started to go around, and they were looking into the microwave like this. And then it went bing, and I took the thing, and I put the shirt on. I was like, yeah, that's how we roll. That's what we do. And I'll never forget what he said. He says, Brother Dan, the Western church is like that. You go 1, 2, ping. one, two, ping, and everything's ready for you. He said, but you don't know how to wait on the Lord. You know what? He was right. Those that wait on the Lord. I think there's times, churches, and I wanted to start, invite us to do it in just a moment, just to stand in his presence. And just stand and just wait and see what he'll do. Can I ask you right where you are just to stand? You just open your hands to him. I know time's almost gone. There's so much to be done. We are one people. We have a passion, one passion. And we have one purpose. And it's a big purpose. But you know, in Peter, it says this. You can hasten, Peter says, the day of his return. We can hasten the day of his return. Another translation says we can hurry it along. You know, we can, if we will get the job done, Jesus will come back. There's a word in the Bible which I love. You can do a study on it. It's the word until. Everyone say until. Until God has given ministries, until we all reach maturity and unity in the faith. You know, there's unity in the spirit and there's unity in the faith. Until you reach unity in the faith, there's an until. The psalmist says, and the Lord said to my Lord, I will make all your enemies a footstool for your feet. In Acts chapter 3:21, it says this, the Son of Man must remain in heaven until the restoration of all things has taken place. Until there is stuff that has to happen. And we can wait on him in a place and say, God, I'm waiting for you. And church, this morning, I just want to invite you, just close your eyes and say, God, I'm waiting here for you. And I want you to think for a moment, what is the impossible thing that you are facing that you know God wants you to break through? What is that paper lining? It's just been there. You know, it could have been there for years. And say, no. But today, as I lie on my bed, anticipating a few days from now, where I'm going to smash a world record. And you know, it could just be you're the one in an area in your family, in your business, an area in your health or your finances, you think, no, I'm going to smash through. I'm going to break through. And you know what will happen is when you do, other people will follow. What a beautiful picture of leadership. What a beautiful picture of being an example. Lord, send me. Lord, pick me. Lord, choose me. Lord, use me. I want to be that guy that waits until the body is fitly joined together as each part does its work, as it grows and builds itself up in love, as the family functions under the wonderful, gracious, loving Father that we have. As the army is drawn for battle under the great command of the great King Jesus. And the house, not made of bricks, not made of bricks and mortar, but made of living stones where God can make his dwelling. Father, I just thank you so much this morning. I thank you for this house. I thank you for this church. I thank you, as we've heard so many times, that from all the different turns and all the different seasons that we've gone through, you've never left us. You've never left this house. Your hand has never departed from the seed that was put in the ground. I thank you for the DNA. I thank you, Lord, that you are God with us. And Holy Spirit, I ask that you would just come afresh, Holy Ghost, the great paraclete, the one that comes alongside, the great comforter, the great counselor, that you would come this morning and you would flood this place afresh, that as we stand here, then we learn again just to wait for you as one people with one holy passion and one heavenly purpose. God, we just say, use us. Use us, Lord. We're ready. We're ready for you.